Hello there everyone, it's uxwbill here once again to fulfill a video request that was made a couple of weeks ago, back when I received and made a video about the CRL Systems TVS-3001 television audio processor that I received in the mail. Now, there's a little bit of a story behind this, and then there's a little bit of a disclaimer. I guess I'll start with the story first, because that's a lot more fun. Several months ago, as many of you are no doubt aweare, fellow YouTuber and friend of mine, Weasel2HTM, started doing his own blog TV show where he would spin his records, tapes, and CDs, as well as produce humorous commentary on various things and talk with us ninnies out in the chat pane who were trying very hard to make him laugh, so much so, in fact, that one time he actually shut off his monitor so that we could no longer distract him, and boy, then was the fun over. Well, I was inspired to relive something of a childhood dream of mine, and a couple months after his show began, I started my own blog TV show that I have done whenever time permits. We've had a lot of fun with that. My brothers and I, the Keykeeper, Bizarre Furhead, we've all been down here on the show. Even my mother's been on the show, and my dad's been within spitting distance of the camera, although we haven't persuaded him to walk out in front of it just yet. However, there is one problem. As anyone who owns any quantity of recorded music will no doubt be very well aware, every piece of recorded music is prepared according to a slightly different standard regarding overall loudness, tonal balance, and, you know, things like compression for the dynamic range, stuff like that. When you're just listening to music for the fun of it on your home stereo, or you're listening to one particular album, it's not really a problem. The problem comes in when you start playing bits and pieces from different musical sources, and you discover that everything is a different level. Now, so far, I've been taking care of this the manual way, which is to say, I've got my little battle mixer down here in the computer mess room, and, you know, I was just kind of riding the faders and watching the meters, trying to keep everything approximately the same level. And I don't suppose that I have been hugely successful at that. Basically, my biggest concern was keeping things away from clipping, and as far as I know, outside of a few instances where we got a little carried away on the microphones, I've never had any trouble with the audio clipping. Well, now I've got a solution to that, because fellow YouTuber V Westlife, who is very much into broadcast technology, broadcast practices, broadcast audio processing, things like that, he demonstrated the CRL Systems TVS-3001 audio processor. And what that is an automatic gain control. It basically watches the volume level, the amplitude level of incoming audio, and it adjusts the gain as necessary to keep things at a point where they all sound relatively the same. That's pretty much all it does. Well, I decided that this might be the thing that I wanted to use on my blog TV show as well. So I turned to eBay, and I found one. They're not hard to find. In fact, if you bide your time, I'm sure one will come along, and it seems to me that the fair price for one of them these days is probably right around $100. You certainly shouldn't give a whole lot more than that. Well, I'm going to go ahead and talk about the CRL Systems TVS-3001 audio processor as part of the video request that was made a couple of weeks ago. However, I must say that broadcast audio processing and technology is far from my center of expertise, so it's quite possible that I'll get something wrong, in which case I would certainly appreciate a gentle, reasonable correction. And if I run out of intelligent things to say about the device, well, I guess I'll just have to make something entertaining up. It should be said that if you're thinking of getting a CRL Systems TVS-3001 for yourself, it would probably be a very good idea to download the operating and installation manual for it. You can get that from the Orban Broadcast FTP site. Now, not every popular web search engine will index FTP sites, but Google does. And if you type in CRL TVS-3001, one of the first results to be returned will be a link to the manual. And the manual is very useful not only because it tells you how to set it up, it also gives you information on the theory of operation, and it also provides nearly complete schematics and an alignment procedure should the unit require repair or adjustment. It can certainly talk about these things more intelligently than I can, so if you really want to understand everything that this unit is doing, you should definitely go ahead and download a copy of the owner's manual. The TVS-3001 is not the first device that I acquired in the hopes of keeping the audio level on my blog TV show relatively constant. Right here is the first unit that I tried. This is a Behringer Minicom Modeling Compressor, model number COM-800. Now, a compressor really isn't the kind of thing you would want to use to keep the volume levels the same across different sources, but this thing has a number of presets that govern its operations, and one of the presets that seemed particularly relevant to the cause of keeping the volume level constant across sources was the preset at the bottom, identified as Leveler. According to the user's manual for this unit, the Leveler preset is used to make the volume level between different sources the same. Unfortunately, it doesn't quite live up to the expectations that I had, because this thing is only a downward-facing compressor. That is to say, it can only do anything when the audio level gets high enough that it needs to intervene. It can do nothing to bring a quiet source up in volume level to match louder sources. So it wasn't really what I wanted, and that led to my acquisition of the TVS-3001 based on what I saw in fellow YouTuber V. Westlife's video. Now, this unit looks a little different from the others that I have seen, most notably because of the cover over the controls. You'll notice that it says CRL Television, and I love the script font that they use to render the word television. There's also a CRL Systems logo down in the lower corner. I don't know when this change took place, but the unit I have is definitely later production because the date codes inside it indicate that it was probably produced sometime around the end of the year 2001. CRL actually introduced these things back around the dawn of MTS stereo television, because this is a stereo audio processor, in 1986 or so. Now, the control panel on the front doesn't reveal a whole lot with the door closed. In fact, the only thing that's normally visible on the front panel without opening any doors is the select button that you see right here. There's also the display, which can indicate a number of different things. It indicates the level of the input signal. It indicates the level of the output signal. It indicates the status of the stereo difference, L plus R, L minus R signal. And it also indicates how much gain reduction is taking place. There are a few other indicators over here, and some of these come into play automatically. Others are enabled by opening up this control panel and actually flipping switches. You can see that there is an indicator right there marked gain lock. And what the gain lock function does, when the incoming signal gets quiet enough, if this thing did not stop turning up the gain and reducing its level of gain reduction, the noise floor would come up louder. The tape hiss or record crackles, something like that. So when the sound gets quiet enough, this thing enters a gain lock mode where the gain settings will not move from wherever they currently are. Here's the control panel opened up. You can see there's a space for a screwdriver that's actually still present on this unit. I'm not sure if it's the original screwdriver, but no matter, it works just as well nevertheless. At the extreme left of the control panel is a bank of dip switches that are used to set the calibration of the level meter over here. Right next to those are a pair of screw terminals that say input level. Now, the input level is not what you think it might be. It's not the actual audio level that goes into this thing's main audio path. What the input level governs is actually the level of the audio that goes through the control path. The control path is the circuit logic that decides how much gain reduction should be applied. Next to that is a pink noise and operate switch. The pink noise function is utilized to achieve maximum stereo separation in conjunction with the output level controls, and it's also used to help you set your levels. The filter switch actually turns on a 15.7 or so kilohertz filter that blocks out the television horizontal scan frequency as well as the NTSC color frequency. Next to that is a polarity adjustment switch. Now, the polarity adjustment switch is kind of interesting, but anyone who's ever miswired stereo speakers will probably understand its purpose. The idea of the polarity switch is to correct any out-of-phase conditions, that is to say, where the positive and negative connections on, say, the right channel as compared to the left channel are reversed from one another. What this can cause is a form of phase cancellation, where the sound level is greatly attenuated or potentially even eliminated entirely. Plus, it also causes odd effects with bass signals and things like that. If this thing's circuit logic should detect that the phase of an audio signal coming into it is incorrect, it can reverse the phase. You can actually turn that on to an automatic setting, or you can force it to be turned on. Either way, if it's enabled, the phase reverse indication will appear on the front panel. If it's forced on, it appears all the time. If it's automatically detecting a phase reversal and correcting for it, it comes on whenever that happens. And I actually ran the Weasel Show through this thing a couple of days ago, and there were a few times that its phase reverse indication did react due to variations in the source material. The loudness button is a sort of loudness control circuit to help make the loudness of something seem similar to other somethings. And then, on the end, yeah, I know, that's probably a hatchet job of explaining that, but there it is lit up and illuminated. Whoops, come back here. So you can see what that does. The proof and operate switch on the end is used to determine how the audio sounds without the processor affecting it. If you turn it up to the proof setting, the processor is completely bypassed, where if you turn it down to the operate setting, the processor is in full effect and you hear it processing the audio on the output. Speaking of inputs and outputs and stuff, here's a look at the back panel of the unit near the audio connections. There are a lot more than just audio connections back here. It's actually possible to control a number of this unit's features using remote trigger signals. There's also an output where you can tap this thing's 15-volt power supply to operate other devices within, of course, this thing's power supply limits. I don't know how much current carrying ability this power supply has, but I will say it's definitely overbuilt because that heatsink that you see over there never gets more than mildly warm to the touch. This thing can accept either balanced or unbalanced audio inputs via these screw terminals. I'm running an unbalanced input setup here, and as you can see, per the CRL manual, I have actually shorted on the input side. You don't want to short them on the output side, the negative portion of the signal and the ground terminal, because I'm not using them in an unbalanced setup. And then I have unbalanced stuff on the outputs as well. There are even more settings on the inside of this unit, everything from power supply voltage adjustment trimmers to jumper blocks that determine how various aspects of the circuitry operate. While it is unquestioned that CRL Systems probably held a patent on this device, if not several patents, they took things a step further in protecting their intellectual property, which is a term that makes me twitchy whenever I hear it, but it seems to be what everybody's calling it, so I just did the same thing. Inside this unit, along with many other broadcast processors, dating all the way back to devices like the CBS Automax processor, are modules that have a poor man's patent applied to them, a poor man's patent being potting compound. There are two modules inside this thing that serve to give it its unique personality. I have no idea why, if it was the late date of this unit's production or whatever, this unit does not have those two modules encased in potting compound so you can clearly see the components that make them up. That'll be nice if it ever needs to be serviced. As you can see, the processor is intended for rack mounting with the screw holes at each end. There's also a place on the side where you can attach rails. I'm not sure how much this particular example was used because the front panel is pretty clean and the plastic is unscathed and unscarred. Until I got a hold of it, the zinc chromate top, which is that pretty reflective metal you're looking at, was actually completely unscarred as well, but I put a bit of a scuff in it back here around the power supply vents, which kind of made me a little bit mad. No matter, this unit is in excellent working order, and now I'm going to give you a demonstration of it with various source materials here. You can see I've got a turntable up top. The stereo receiver is just acting as a phono preamplifier because I couldn't find my little tiny phono preamp. I have a tape deck and I have a CD player. And the microphone is just here because I made a test recording and handed it off to someone so they could listen to it and see what they thought. So let's go ahead and have a little demonstration here of how this thing makes various audio sources seem to have the same apparent loudness. And it does a pretty darn good job of it. I point that out because not every process that this unit performs is linked to both stereo channels of output. The first stage of automatic gain control is linked. The second stage of audio processing is not. Each channel can behave independently. And when you have a system set up that way, what can happen if, say, a lot of gain reduction or compression is being applied to one channel without being applied to the other? You can get odd shifting of the stereo image, which is very disconcerting to listen to. Even though this unit does not fully lock all of its processing stages, it does not have the channels locked together, I have very seldom, if ever, noticed the stereo image shifting between channels. And this thing does a very good job. It's very transparent to my ears. Now, I don't claim to have golden ears, but from what I can hear, it's doing a very nice job. So I guess the first source that I'll start with, assuming my mixer is still set up appropriately, is the turntable record. And then the cassette tape.
Welcome back. Your dreams were your ticket out. Welcome back to that same old place that you laughed about. Well, the names have all changed since you hung around, but those dreams have remained.
And finally, some examples from the CD player.
She weren't much to look at. She weren't much to ride. She was missing a window on her passenger side. The floorboard was patched up with paper and tar. But I really was something in my old yellow car.
Crying when she told me goodbye. But I knew the load, it was breaking her heart, but she was breaking mine. So for the sake of her feelings and the sake of my pride, I told her.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Mambo number 5.
In closing, there's not a whole lot left to say about this thing. I will say that of all the parameters you can adjust, the attack and release times are not out there for you to adjust. Perhaps they could be affected through internal adjustments, I don't know. I haven't studied the circuit closely enough, and I'm certainly not about to risk the health and well-being of this device to twiddle with its internals without having A, an understanding of what I'm doing, and B, the proper equipment with which to align it. Because those times are fixed, it does lead to some interesting things taking place. Sometimes if you have a quiet source that's been playing and a louder source comes on, and that source takes very little time to reach its level of loudness, this thing doesn't respond quite quickly enough to keep there from being an audible increase in the apparent volume level. Likewise, if you have a loud source playing and then you go to a quieter one, I've noticed that this thing takes a little bit of time to back off on the amount of gain reduction that it's applying. Oh, by the way, there's definitely a thing or two that I forgot. When this baby hits 88 miles an hour, you're gonna see some serious shit. Sheep science! Oh man, where the heck am I? That was a pretty bad trip. Anybody got a phone? I think I need to call AAA. You know, I definitely think the key keeper is on the right track, but he's gonna need a bigger can to put the whole truck in.
Get in there. There, I got it. Now, can I get a dumpster in the back?
Have you ever had a time when your microwave oven just won't cook what you want it to? When it burns your microphones and undercooks your frozen dinners, and it's just not going according to plan? We here at Stereo Dust Particles, the Stereo Store, with a whole lot more, have your solution, because we recently acquired on closeout a number of CRL Systems TVS-3001 processors. Ordinarily, these wouldn't have anything to do with microwave ovens, but we fixed ourselves up an adapter kit from the finest manufacturers in China, and now we have the perfect feedback-style automatic microwave oven gain controller. Never again will you suffer undercooked microphones, overcooked frozen dinners, random explosions that open warps in the time-space continuum. Call today, because supplies are, as they say, limited.